Cosgrove, speaking to Mr. Flynn, and Robert Redford, but he basically says it's all about controlling information. This was 30 years ago. Hot tomato focus on electronic hacks from the last 30 years, and almost all of them are related to something to do with information, something from the CIA, you know, attacks on confidentiality, integrity. So yeah, it's controlling the information. I'll briefly go through the structure of the talk to try to help you get more out of it, help you be organized. We meet up to the hacks. I do have a Q&A section in the weekend, but because the hacks are kind of self-moving, so going through those, if there are any questions, feel free to just shout them out as we cover all of our time. As I mentioned, we're going to talk about hacks with no technical details. These are all from publicly released information. So thank you for bringing us all some of other information that might be related, might not have been released, might have made for some different information. The controls that I'm going to go over are security controls that could have prevented the attack and detected the attack, as well as maybe some controls that have been implemented since then. So the attacks are vital. And their effects upon us are how they affect us. This is going to be political and economic and social effects. With political, there's a little fuzziness there. Governmental could be regulatory bodies, standards bodies. Economic, micro issues, macro, maybe a specific industry, which might be more macro, or maybe a specific organization, which might be more micro, and various social effects. The talk is itself, as a whole, is largely with a parody of the call, take on the movies that made us, or the movies that made us, if you all have seen them. That kind of did the same thing. The cultural effects that are from those specific boys or women's kind of do with these hacks. The first hack is AOL. This was according to the reading here, basically used to annoy others as a tool set. Got people offline with it, email bomb codes, do phishing, other types of social engineering attacks. And it was initially released in 1994. The last version was released in 1995. There were various betas that were released as well. The initial concept was a bunch of macros that we used within AOL. Later versions, like version 3, were written into Unix, and it was largely impacted by the factors within the environment of the mid-90s, right? Large quantities of non-technical people coming online with tools, ISPs like AOL, make that possible. And as a result, they released tools like AOL, account creator, EWCC Fisher, a phishing component of this tool that could be used to attack these cyber users. At the time, AOL was a service that paid by the hour. Their usage was paid by the hour. They later, years after, they came to an unlimited model where they all this sort of just buy one single limited service, pay monthly. But the time they were using a built model that paid by the hour. So one of these tools was free AOL. And the way it worked, the way the hack worked, was it enumerated all the Windows handles, sent messages to show those, so that it wouldn't start the accounting of time. At the time, if you went to a feature within AOL that was free, such as billing, you want to see your bills and see how given charge for your hour usage, but hide all those other windows, bring up the billing window, and then it did not account for the time you spent in that window. So you get charged for that. Well, the way this worked was, it basically hit all those other windows, and AOL thought you were still looking at your billing for 20 hours. Another feature of this whole set is the fake account creator. At the time, AOL was only validating the credit card number checksum. So if you don't know, there are algorithms that are used to create credit card numbers and specific types of card numbers. Visa, American Express, MasterCard have a certain configuration or algorithm that can be used to create a valid number. It can be validated by their checksum. However, they weren't validating that credit card number was actually assigned to a user who could be billed. So what this tool did was it created all the info you needed to sign up for a fake account, pre-filled that info, and allowed you to set it up. Our accounts were usually good for more than 10 to 30 days based on the billing cycle, and how long it took AOL to realize, hey, we're not going to make your fake accounts. Lastly, one of the tools, one of the features of this tool set was the PWCC Fisher. This was a tool that allowed you to mass IM rooms, these chat rooms, which were some of the first chat rooms in the early to mid-90s, that masses of folks joined. But you could IM these rooms with some sort of pretext. There's suggestions to read me what you say, your AOL staff number, and need the user's credit card number to assist with their account or their password. Save these responses to a file on the disk that you can review later or regret through for those actual passwords or credit card numbers. So, what controls could have prevented this? Well, the pre-AOL tool could have ensured your time frame and started with usage. You still see this the same type of tactic, I guess, used in attacks and web apps today, where you bypass authorization, right? Where if there was a control set up to where you weren't able to bypass it, that would stop it. The fake account creator either to verify the credit card numbers that are actually active and valid with credit card companies, the processor, which is essentially what they ended up doing to mitigate this issue. And user education is always a great solution for phishing, making sure users are aware of who should be contacting them or not contacting them. Detected controls, auditing and alerting on significant variations between log-on time and free time. So, yeah, again, if you spend 20 hours in a month on AOL, and 19 and a half of those hours are in the free billing area, that's an issue. Most legitimate users are not to spend approximately 95% of their time in the free area. How did it change? There were very few, if none, political effects. The economic effects were unknown. Obviously, AOL lost some revenue they had to pay to get some of these issues addressed, but that was never accomplished. The biggest thing is that this is the first documented use of the term phishing PH. I don't know if you noticed in the screenshot of the tool, some of it referred to F. Some use, this one shows it, PH. This is the first documented using of phishing with PH. Moving forward to 2000, we have the I Love You virus. This had spread by an email message. You had it attached, which is not a script, a Visual Basic script. Run the script, did lots of damage, but overwrote random Office files, image files, hid all your MP3 files, which 2000, and probably a bunch of them. And it then copied itself into all the email messages that were sent to all the contacts in your address book. It affected Outlook and targeted Windows systems. At that time, Windows was 95% of the desktop market share, so they had 95% of the desktop market share. Outlook was installed as a default email client. fall with those configurations did file extensions for known file types. And so what would happen is users would get this email, the attachment that was love letter or some variation of that, .text, .pbs, and all they saw was the .text. In order to try and get the user to click on it, thinking it was a text file, it was a script file, which they could execute. And it spread that way. There have been other notable worms prior to this, such as the Morris worm that widespread impacts, as well as other email viruses such as the Melissa virus from 1999 that also was widespread. What made this different was because of the amount of damage and the fact that it just moved in waves, it caused a very significant amount of damage. It caused outages due to email service having to be taken offline at some of these organizations. Microsoft, moved in a wave, started in Southeast Asia, moved out to Hong Kong, China, US, Western Europe. And so many of these organizations knew it was coming, but weren't really able to mitigate it in any other way than taking their servers offline. Police in the Philippines identified a computer student that was responsible for it, the author. They were not able to prosecute because there weren't any laws to control user education again, release with execution of attachments, disabling hidden file extensions, type of the known file type, antivirus effects and detective correction. Obviously, it would need some sort of signature or some way to catch it as well. Plus, back, this is the amount of damage of deleted office files. Also, a significant amount of damage to small organizations who may have not had a response plan, may have not had good backup procedures, and they lost a lot of data. Some of the effects upon us were, well, one, they created a law, Philippine Congress and NACS were Public Act 8792, so they're now being prosecuted for computer crimes. This is estimated to have caused more than $10 billion in damage across the world. And I love this. This is actually the quote from Kevin Paulson. He said that Windows users everywhere learn never, ever open up unsolicited attachments. This is 2000. Of course, that's coming. Operation Get Rich or Die Trying, Great Cyber Heist. This was a hack, a series of hacks, really, targeted mostly retail organizations in the mid-2000s to get credit card data. The group is known as the Green Hat Enterprises Group, that's what they call themselves. Not White Hat, not Black Hat, but the Green Hat, led by Albert Gonzalez. At the time, or at least at the beginning of this, Albert Gonzalez was a Secret Service informant and participated in Operation Firewall, which was an operation of the Secret Service in conjunction with some other agencies to take down a carding forum known as Shadow Group. He moved to Miami during that time period, like right after that had happened. And many of these retail stores had locations along kind of that corridor, the I-95 corridor there, that could easily be attacked. Initial vectors included Wi-Fi, weak Wi-Fi networks, and SQL injection on web commerce sites. Initially, there was so much data in one of these sites to get back to. So much transaction data was stored that they couldn't find the good data to be able to sell it quickly. I read something like 1 in 20 of the numbers they were getting were just already expired cards that they could sell the numbers. SQLWatt created a sniffer program to find good data, encrypt it, and then they had a process for exfiltrating it out. From the other slide, you can see that a lot of organizations, the jackpot was when they landed on Heartland Payment Systems. Heartland Payment Systems was a payment processor for credit card transactions, and they compromised the website by a SQL, the corporate website of HPS. HPS actually identified the activity, shut them down. Had some response, thought they had eradicated them. The attackers, time goes by, and they jump from the that corporate network to the payment processing network, which is where they did the damage. The takeover all for these attacks, it led to compromise of millions of credit card numbers and card number data. There were some cash out efforts that were conducted by the crew, and I said crew, it's very loosely organized group of individuals that kind of shared some similar interests and goals and objectives. Other dumps were fenced through a reseller. This is eventually how they got caught. It typically is in a lot of criminal organizations that get caught where something is sold or fenced and they work their way back up through the hierarchy. Controls that could potentially prevent it, specific for the Wi-Fi, was strong encryption. I mean, this was the time of web and WPA or not WPA2 yet. Isolating the wireless networks that were transmitting card data, some of the compromises included wireless networks that were transmitting card data and cardholder data. Changing default passwords, purging sensitive data when no longer needed, logging and monitoring and alerting for anomalous activity. This is, all that stuff that Chris just talked about. Using a WAF to monitor and block HTTP requests for SQL injection. Put the WIDs down here. Of course, WIDs are probably not effective. The WIDs would be corrected. Political effects. This activity and the losses during that time for those organizations actually prompted the creation of the PCI DSS wireless guidelines, or at least a body was stood up to investigate wireless security as a result of some of this, and that body ended up producing these guidelines. It's estimated there were around $400 million in damage. Some of these estimates are not very good. Great. This estimate comes from the Department of Justice press release related to political motives and complaint estimates. There also could be some of the compromised organizations that had costs that didn't ever get reported. Social effects really were none. Next step. Web War One. I call this the rehearsal for Cyber War. So we're booted, we're in the mid-2000s, this is 2007. This is a distributed denial of service attack. And this was an attack against Estonia. If you're not familiar with this, at the time Estonia was highly connected. It's an Eastern European country that was formerly part of the Soviet Union and made independence in the 90s, I think, early 90s. And was, like many of those countries, moving closer and closer towards ties with Europe at the time, joined NATO, and they were highly connected. It's estimated that at the time of this attack, 90% of their banking transactions were conducted online. So this is 15 years ago, this country had 90% of their banking transactions conducted online. Most of their voting, a lot of their political and governmental functions were conducted online. This is the origin of Skype, which is kind of a fun fact. Prior to Microsoft buying it, it actually got designed and came from Estonia. The environment at the time that kind of led to this was this bronze soldier here. It was a statue in remembrance of all of the Russian soldiers that had died fighting the Nazis in World War II. There had been significant lost lives there. So we was going to move this from a central square in Berlin to a cemetery area that was somewhat nearby, but didn't have the prominent the central square in. It kicked off a series of riots internal with ethnic Russians that were in Estonia, Estonian citizens that were ethnically Russian, they started rioting, there was a lot of physical damage, cars overturned. Russia released a statement that warned Estonia that they removed the statue would be disastrous for Estonia. The event seems to kind of end, calms down, right on the streets at least, and then the beat-off starts. The only way they found to mitigate the impact is the sheer amount of attackers. This was several botnets composed of tens of thousands of attackers. It was to cut off access from around the world to internal web resources. So, this is an individual effort on these individual sites. They created denials international track to these sites to rock, basically. Activists that work with ISPs around the world to filter out this initial traffic, and a week after this DDoS stops. The attack consisted mostly of just straight DDoS attacks, but there was some other type of attacks conducted on website pages and on commercial sites. DNS attacks, DNS name servers that were located in Estonia. There was a mass effort of email spam that kind of overwhelmed the email servers that were located there. By chance, one of the DNS admins for a root DNS server happened to be in Estonia, and he was attending an European network operators meeting. And he, along with two other DNS admins for root DNS servers, helped the Estonian surge to be able to kind of acted as liaisons between them and other ISPs around the world. They were able to link credibility to the calls because they were having issues trying to get ISPs to filter some of this traffic so that they could get these compromised systems and provide that around the world to customers and ISPs or trying to originate these ISPs to filter that traffic out. So they quieted down. There was a second wave of attacks that began at midnight Moscow town time. Night, which is Victory Day in Russia. This was a day to celebrate victory over the Axis power of two. And this is a quote from Putin. Explicitly references this. Those who are trying today to desecrate the memorials of war heroes. Attacks disappear by evening. This is a modern map of NATO. Estonia's You see like Ukraine joining now and some of the Canadian countries. NATO declines to consider an Article 5 or Article 4 response. So Article 5 is a commitment from NATO members to mutual defense. This is the big factor or commitment that NATO members make to each other. If Saudi attacks you, Russia attacks you, some of these other powers, you're going to have your back. Article 4 is the beginning of that formal discussion. It's the process for formal discussion of the North Atlantic Council. And there was some debate over whether this attack really originated from Russia or whether it originated from other actors, maybe within Russia, maybe with Russia's support. And so NATO declines to consider either of these ones. Manny Greenberg's book, The Same Worm, he proposes that this basically confirms for Russia the lack of political will within NATO to defend these organizations when there's a cyber attack that especially might have some plausible deniability. There were no kinetic attacks associated with this. These were all just cyber attacks. This is why I said this is rehearsal for the board. It allowed, obviously, to demonstrate the capability that somebody had, whether it was Russia or other actors. It also ensured that, or confirmed that what the response would look like. There's not a lot that you can do to prevent that amount of traffic. I guess you can have a CPN with DDoS protection. At some point, when you have hundreds of these large botnets attacking you, it's going to be very hard to prevent that traffic. You can have detective dashboards that alert on it, maybe before your site totally goes down, you'll start to see an increase in bandwidth utilization, a lack of capacity. The big thing with this hack is what I mentioned before. This is kind of the first effort that we know of. There was an effort before then that had not been released at the time, had been publicly released, called Titan Ring, where China attacked the Department of Defense systems. As I mentioned, it was still unclear with this specific one, the attack on Estonia, whether Russia was behind the attack, but the attack seems to have had a purpose of punishing Estonia for disrespecting Russia or disrespecting the citizens of either ethnically Russian. The issue is that it basically had the opposite effect. Estonia rapidly moves even closer to the West after this event. It's kind of similar to what's happening with Ukraine right now, where there's an activity that's happening and it may have some effects that were not intended by driving other countries to support inclusion of Estonia and Ukraine into Western Europe in a faster pace. The Tallinn Manual was published by CCD-COE. CCD-COE was formed. This is NATO's Cooperative Cyber Defense Center of Excellence. It is the organization that is responsible for creating guidance on how to defend yourself. The Tallinn Manual is essentially a guidebook on cyber war, a law manual, an international law related to cyber operation. And socially, we saw that now, if it wasn't Russia that did this attack, they didn't stop it. So the nation-state actor could have stopped the attack. It gave us a better understanding of what cyber attacks conducted by nation-state actors or sanctioned indirectly by nation-state actors would look like. Let's move forward to operational war. This is industrial.
I guess a quick question on the previous one. So even though I guess it introduced this organization within NATO, is it fair to say that we still to this day, even though we've had Stuxnet, Sandworm, not even the current conflict with Ukraine, cyber attacks against Ukraine, there's still no formal precedent for what can make a cyber attack trigger traditional warfare? Is that a fair statement to say?
There, as far as I'm aware, there are no formal treaties or agreements that have been signed that specifically detail that. There is precedent within other international law that could be applied, and that's what you see referenced in the Tallinn Manual, is other rules of engagement for armed conflicts as well as other international law. So that is just described there. Yeah, I think there's still room for a specific agreement, some type of something published at an international level to guide us on cyber war. This manual does go into rules of engagement cyber war and kind of the tit for tat, what would necessitate or give the ability to do a kinetic attack for a cyber attack. That's listed. And most of the organizations that are members of NATO probably are using this at least at some point to inform their policy related to this operation. That's a good question. So operational war, this is industrial espionage is here. New organizations were attacked. Some of these that are listed are ones that were reported on the pack. I've never actually come out and said they were attacked, so keep that in mind. The initial attacks started with spear phishing, very, very good spear phishing methods. If I could have access to internet, intellectual property, the attacks appear to come from interesting sources, they knew who these people were receiving emails from, they knew what the format of emails looked like well enough to be able to conduct a very effective spear phishing attack once it started. The user would open a file, which exploited a security internet explorer. That was the initial report related to Google. Programmatic even may have been vectors other than the IP0-day the initial vector as well. Some reports have noted potential vulnerabilities in Adobe Reader that may have been exploited, had to confirm. The name actually Aurora comes from a file path where it's loading debugging symbols or it was on the developer system. So that's where the name Aurora comes from. Exploit targeted IE6, but not long after this was reported and some information got out to security researchers, the new attack was created or the factor that was able to target IE7 and IE8 as well. Google was one of the main organizations was attacked. It focused on two targets within Google, the email accounts of users that were associated with Chinese human rights activists as well as source code for Google products. There was a second zero-day that was used to access the software configuration management tool, Workforce, which is what Google was using for some of their code management at the time, code repos. And Google concludes the attackers, at least in email, didn't have access or didn't obtain their objectives because they didn't get access to the body of the email, but they were able to access the dates and times that were created, as well as the subject lines of all those emails. There is a great McAfee report too on and their analysis of the vulnerabilities in Workforce. This is a great example of these types of attacks are fuzzy. They're gray. Attribution is hard. The McAfee called this attack and this group Aurora. Symantec called it Elderwood. CrowdStrike called it Sneaky Panda. They all called it Beijing Group. This is the screenshot of the minor attack framework listing for that group. There were many other CVEs used and identified. The goal against all those organizations, the common goal seemed to be intellectual properties, source code. When the IE11 got patched, I started doing waterfall attacks and some other investments, some of these other CVEs are related to. What could stop this? Again, it's spear phishing, but user education. Very good spear phishing. Running SCM software as a non-privileged user, that's one of the vulnerabilities that seems to be an issue. Also, if you create new users without authenticating, be bad. Encrypting SEM data in transit, you can capture data that was being transmitted and access to sensitive data. That last one may or may not have been used in actual attacks. Antivirus, logging and monitoring and learning anomalous activity. This really kind of ties into what Chris said earlier, because if you know what specific threat actor is doing, you can do adversarial integration on this type of activity, make sure you've got the detections and quick detectives. this increase tension between the U.S. and China, significantly, there are other factors as well, but politically, this got even worse. We had Operation Aurora, and later the OPM breach we had because of treaties with China. There's a meeting between Xi Jinping and President Xi Jinping. President Obama in 2015, that it was reported this was discussed, as well as a meeting between President Xi Jinping and President Trump in 2017, where it was reported it was discussed. The activity seems to tail off, at least from this specific threat, but then there also is a reorganization of those threat actors in China, too. It's unknown the economic impact. There hasn't been a lot released. Obviously, Google leaving China, the second largest market in the world, is significant. There were other contributing factors at the time, China wanting to censor their Google search results. It was a stiff market anyway. There was lots of competition. Very challenging market because of stiff competition. But overall, it was very significant amount of IP stolen that likely has been used for mining for security vulnerabilities, as well as could be used to benefit China commercially or businesses within China commercially. Socially, it's just another indicator really around this time when it was published of China's already been human rights activists. That's a strong indicator. So this is kind of the ultimate example of cyber weapon, cyber war. You've got a cyber attack, and that leads to genetic damage. Cyber weapon deployed. So there were a wide array of different families of malware that were associated with Stuxnet. Some version before this. Other versions after this. I was going to refer specifically to this version, which was the initial one that was reported on. Their initial attack vector into these organizations, the initial attack vector was these organizations in June 2009. And we have evidence that there was a engineer from NADA Industrial Group, that posted on a forum about a problem with stealing Step 7 DLL files. He suspected the problem was caused by a virus that was spread by flash drives. There's no other, talent search for something on these forums and look for a solution, and you never know if they found a solution or not. There's nothing else to do. Five months later, a Belarusian firm, Virus Block Data, they're doing some analysis on malware identified from systems in Iran, discovered some zero-day. It was used, and the zero-day used malicious link files were spread by flash drives. Plug in, you can actually go to look at the image from a link file or an icon. And this is how they exploited it. They also found the malicious use of an organization, Realtek Semiconductor, in their search to sign some of the drivers that were used. Targeted Windows by a 4-0 day attack, which still to this day is a significant amount of burning of 0 days for any type of cyber weapon. We really wanted it to spread. Besides this, there were other techniques that we used as well. Like one of the things that targeted as well were some of the vulnerabilities related to the trigger. The malicious link file I mentioned, frequently the 0 days of privilege escalation by a vulnerable keyboard file, Windows print spooler vulnerability, and Windows task scheduling vulnerability were all of you. Once it could spread and get to a Windows system, the payload would target step seven software that can project files in order to be able to conduct. Stuff like this on a Saturday, so thank you because you make this community.